Okay, imagine this. You are a machine. When you break, what do? We don't just point fingers. We open you up, look for what went wrong, and fix the issue. When a program crashes, we don't say it's useless. We debug the code, figure out what went wrong, and give it a second chance. But when a human being cracks, when someone loses control, acts out of character, or breaks down, what do? We just point fingers. We label them too emotional, sensitive, rude, lazy, but we never think about checking their brains, do we? We never ask what's going on inside. What if I told you that our human brain, this soft, squishy, 3-pound thing in our head, is not a fixed static organ? What if I told you it's more like a software, the one that can be updated, debugged, and reprogrammed? What if I told you that right now, your thoughts, your emotions, even the stories you tell yourself are reshaping your brain? Today, I want to talk to you about something we rarely think about, the forgotten superpower of the human brain, because this superpower can either lock you in a cage or set you completely free, and it starts with one simple truth. Your brain is always listening. What is it hearing from you? Now, let's try a quick 5-second experiment. Don't overthink, just follow along. Step 1, think of something that made you really angry last week. Step 2, think of something that made you laugh so hard you almost cried. While you were switching those thoughts, your brain was physically changing. Microscopic changes, actual neural rewiring. We don't feel it, we don't see it, but every thought you think is sculpting your brain like clay. And when you understand that, you'll never think of your thoughts the same way again. Before we go further, hi, I'm Varunika, a class 10 student from Chennai. I've always been fascinated on how the human brain works, how a single organ controls every word we speak, every emotion we feel, and every decision we make. I aspire to become a neurologist, not just to study how the human brain works, but also to help people understand that so many of our thoughts don't just begin with who we are. It also begins with how our brain is functioning. As I began learning more about it, one thought kept coming back. We spend so much time upgrading our phones, fixing bugs in softwares, improving machines, but we never think of upgrading our own minds, do we? No one teaches us to rewire the very thing that runs our life, our brain. So that's what this talk is about. Not some distant scientific theory, but your brain. Let me now take you back to a moment I thought would define me, an inter-school science competition. Now, if you know me, you know this is my zone. I love them. I live for them. I had prepared for weeks. My model was built, coded, tested, an Arduino-based project that screamed innovation lives here. I had practiced my speech so many times that even my mirror got bored of me. So finally, the day arrives. I walked up to the stage, my model in my hand, my head high, thinking, this is it. This is my moment to shine. The spotlight hits in, the judges lean in, and my heart says, go for it. The moment I open my mouth to speak, my brain says, nope, we are out, good luck. Everything I had practiced for weeks disappeared. I looked at the model, at the blinking lights, and felt absolutely nothing, as if someone else built it for me. I tried to explain, I really did, but the words that came out were soft, scattered, slow, not wrong, just unconvincing. The more I panicked, the more my brain shut down, like a tab you forgot to save, crashing at the worst moment. After I stepped off the stage, I wasn't just disappointed, I was devastated. I didn't hear what the judges said. I didn't care about the other teams. I just kept hearing this one voice. You are not who you think you are. You messed up your big moment. Next time, don't even try. That's the thing about failure. The real damage isn't in what happened. It's in the narrative my brain created. And mine turned one, just one awkward moment into a full-blown identity crisis. I didn't just mess up. I was a mess up. And that's what nobody warns you about. Your brain doesn't just whisper gently. It amplifies your worst fears until they feel like facts. Every time I replayed the moment in my head, the story got harsher, the truth got louder, and the voice got meaner. Weeks later, I stumbled upon the video someone had taken off my presentation. And here's the strange part. It wasn't that bad. Yes, I fumbled. Yes, I was nervous, but it never looked like a meltdown. It just looked like a human being doing her best under pressure. It hit me. It hit me so hard because the real damage wasn't on what happened on the stage. It was inside, in the loop my brain had been taught to play. That's when I decided, if my brain can wire itself into a mess, then maybe, just maybe, I can rewire it into something better. That's what this talk is about. Not about forgetting failures, but reframing them. Not pretending they didn't happen, but refusing to let them define you. Our brain is always listening. But here's the good news. It also takes instructions. Every thought you repeat is the brick, and your brain is the house you're building. And just like buildings, some houses can be built like prisons, while the others like palaces. You built it when you say, I'm not good at it. You built it when you scroll and compare yourself with everyone else on Instagram. You built it when you replay an old embarrassment like it's your favorite Netflix show. But you can also build it when you say, I did my best. That moment doesn't define me. I'll show up again stronger. Rewiring is never a one-day thing. It's a one-thought-at-a-time thing. Around that time, something unexpected happened. My beloved principal ma'am, who always encourages us to explore beyond books, handed me a book called Your Brain is Always Listening by Dr. Daniel Amen. Now, I've read science books, but this one felt very different. I didn't feel like I was reading the book. I felt the book was reading me. Page after page, it named things I previously didn't know how to describe. The spirals, the overthinking, the self-doubt I thought only I had, one chapter especially stayed with me. Dr. Amen introduced something called ANTS, automatic negative thoughts, the quiet, persistent whispers like, I'm not good enough. I always mess up. Everyone's judging me. And for the very first time, I realized those weren't just my thoughts. They were just old, unhelpful loops my brain had been taught to play. But what if my brain could be taught a different song? That's when I began to see the human brain, not as a biological organ, but as a mental architecture. And here's what something else hit me. Something deeper. Same brain, different blueprints. Picturize this. Two species, same people, same 86 billion neurons in their skull, but one used it to build a nation while the other one used it to divide the world. Nelson Mandela and Adolf Hitler. Biologically, they were the same, but mentally, they were on different planets. What made the difference is the architecture of their minds, not built by genes, but by choices. The thoughts they had, the beliefs they held, and the stories they chose to leave behind or have it high. That's the place where neurology meets psychology. Neurology asks how the brain works, but psychology asks what's driving the mind inside it. But here's what most people miss. Your brain is the engine. Your mind is the driver, and wherever you take it is entirely up to you. So the question isn't, do I have a good brain? It's, am I driving it well? Because even a Ferrari can crash on the road if the driver thinks they are not good enough. But here's what more important. What if the driver itself is not at fault? What if the engine itself is firing and no one ever cared to check under the hood? And sometimes, that's when I realize that isn't just about motivation, it's also about misunderstanding. Sometimes that misunderstanding can be the difference between compassion and condemnation. I once read this case by Dr. Daniel Amen, the same psychiatrist who introduced the concept of ants. There was a 9-year-old boy called Andrew who always showed terrifying violent behavior. He always spoke about wanting to hurt people and also sometimes wanting to hurt himself. Everyone around him labeled him mentally ill. They called him dangerous. But when Dr. Amen scanned his brain, he found something unexpected. A small cyst pressing on the part of the brain that controls nervous impulses. One simple surgery. All those thoughts disappeared. That story shook me. Because how many people are we judging, rejecting, punishing when their brains are simply crying for help? That's where this idea came to me. Something I call mental architecture. If your brain is the building, then your thoughts are the blueprint. And just like buildings, some brains are built like prisons, while the others like palaces. You don't build it in one day, you build it every day. So, and the best part is that you can also rebuild it, brick by brick, thought by thought, and belief by belief. And the strongest proof of that is never found in a science lab or a textbook. It's found in a prison cell back in South Africa. Let's go back to Mandela. He spent 27 years in prison. You think that would destroy his mind, right? But no. Just like Mandela said, if we don't leave our bitterness behind, we are still in prison. And your thoughts are the key. He didn't just walk out of a cell. He rewired his brain to choose forgiveness, while others in his place would have easily chosen revenge. That's what makes the human brain more powerful. Not just that it can think, but it can also choose what to think. Now, I know what you are thinking. I'm not Mandela. I'm not a legend. I'm not a world leader. I'm just trying to make it through Monday mornings, group projects, teamworks, internship, assignments, right? But here's the truth. You don't need a prison to feel trapped. You don't need to be a world leader. Sometimes the prison is your own mind, full of anxious thoughts, past embarrassments, and voices that tell you you're not good enough. And just like Mandela, you can rewrite your own way out. And now, I know what all of you guys are pondering upon. So, how do we rewire the script? We all wake up with the same basic tool, a brain that listens and a mind that builds. So, how do we make sure we are building something beautiful and not broken? Here are three mental habits that even you and me can start from today. Interrupt the loop. Your brain always runs on loops. I'm not good enough is just a loop that your brain had been taught. So whenever it comes up again, say, stop, that's an old code. I'm rewriting. I am good enough. Choose architects carefully. Your brain doesn't just listen to you. It also listens to people around you. So ask yourself, are the people I'm following breaking me or building me? Improve your standard of advices. Make mind work a ritual. We brush our teeth daily, right? Not when they fall out. So why not we do the same with our brain? Write your thoughts once a week. Speak kindly to yourself on purpose. Say thank you for things you would previously ignore. Train your brain when it's calm. If not, it will crash when it's not. So let me leave you with a question. If I gave you a mirror, not to show your face, but to show the structure of your thoughts, structure of your brain, what would you see? What would you see? Cracks of comparison? Rooms full of self-doubt? Or wide windows of confidence and curiosity? Because your brain is always listening. Speak to it like someone who's building something sacred. Whether you end up building a cage or a palace, that choice starts with you. Because the real barrier isn't society. It isn't technology. It's not even other people. It's the one between who you are today and who your brain still has the power to become. Thank you.